his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush, and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, Certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee, that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, ye shall serve God upon this mountain. And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers hath sent me unto you. What shall they say to me? What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you.
You may be seated. Yo, we have a great study, great teaching this morning. The subject for the teaching this morning, you all, is the sovereign God. The sovereign God, okay? Now, I need you to understand something. Let's check something out in this scripture. Most of us are familiar with the passage in Exodus where he says, I am that I am. Whatever you need, I'm that. Whatever you're going to need, wherever you go, whatever you do, I am that. Today in this teaching, I'm going to call this some Jelani teaching today, okay? Because I'm about to open up some stuff and you're going to like this, okay? I'm about to do some stuff and I'm going to share some information with you in here that I'm pretty sure you haven't heard before, or probably not broken down the way it is. And I thank God for this gift that he gives me so I can share this with you. Because again, this is one of those teachings, as I was preparing you all, there's some information that came out that's gonna be, I think it's gonna be really clear, and it's gonna make it really easy to understand what's going on. So really, clear your canvas, you know, as always, because I think you're gonna learn something today. When we talk about the sovereign God, we mean that God is God all by himself. He does not need anything else to be God. He does not need another being. He does not need another element. He does not need another atom, molecule, anything. He's God all by himself. So when you think about the sovereign God that we speak of, notice this now. Not one thing in creation could be if God was not in it. This is how we got to understand. In the beginning, it says this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and was void. Nothingness, y'all. Nothing, okay? Until God became a part of it, creation did not even come into existence. When he spoke himself into each item, every aspect of creation was when it came into being. So when God added himself into creation was when form came about, because it was without form. It was when God added himself, y'all, that it was no longer void. Void went away. You see? Until God got into it, and until this very day, anything that God is not in, it does not exist. Amen. Y'all okay with this?
Amen.
Now, keep in mind here, you all, that this teaching, I want you to stay focused with me because I think we're going to learn something. I said this, and some of you all can recall some of the teachings in the past. God is the source of intelligence behind all of life and everything that lives. You do all remember that, right? So, if God is not anything, the thing is void. But now, when creation came into existence, it did not come into existence until God made himself a part of it. He called it out, I'm going to be a part of the light. I'm going to be a part of the darkness. Okay? I'm going to be a part of the plant. Everything that came into creation, it did not come into existence until he put himself in it. Is that good? All right, so we got to keep it going here now. Watch this. The spirit that's within every human being, it speaks and it animates, yet it's never seen with the naked eye, but it's no less real because you don't see it. This is where we have this scripture. Check this out. The scripture says this, that which is seen is temporal, that which is not seen is eternal. Look how big that scripture is. Your behavior, what I can see, if you're not coming from a consistent mindset where it's the same all the time, it's temporary. One day you're this way, one day you're the next way. But the part that remains most consistent about you is the spirit of you, the part that I can't see. That is the part that's going to determine your place in heaven. The part that we can't see, the part that's eternal. Check it out. It's not that difficult to understand because watch this. Your spirit, it came from eternity into time to be about the business of God. When you die, your spirit is going to return back to eternity from where it came. Now it gets bigger than that. This is why I stress that you understand the duality of the spirit of God. It is life-giving and it is thought-producing. Keep that in mind, okay? It is life-giving and it is thought-producing. So when the spirit of God enters into you, or when it comes from him and gives you natural life, when you give up natural life, the spirit goes back to the Father from where it came. Can y'all handle that? Okay, we're on the road. So hence we have the understanding that God, the giver of all life, do you think in your wildest imagination that God gave life so Satan can use it? He gave you life so that you would do his bidding.
Amen.
Oh, the teaching gets bigger. So now, you understand this. Out of all of the hell you go through, that you allow Satan to infiltrate your mind and take you through all of this chaos and all of this spiritual destruction that you go through, the reason why is because you have perverted life.
Amen.
Life was never intended for his use. Life was always in. I'm not going to create you to destroy me. So why is it that we give Satan carte blanche access to our thinking? Okay, let's go to the garden, all right? In the beginning, when Adam and Eve were formed in the garden, okay, when Adam first, then Eve, when they were formed in the garden, please understand that evil was already in the world. Evil was already in the world. Satan didn't show up after they got there. But here's the deal. God prepared them for everything. Notice this, you all. Here comes the question that spawned this whole lesson, okay? Why is it that sinless Adam, who was as God, could not resist the temptation to do evil? Now keep in mind, he had not yet sinned. So why is it that sinless Adam could not resist the temptation to do evil? Think on that a little while. I'm going to come back and teach you about it. Now, watch this here, because I want that to get in your head, because see, you never thought about that question. I'm sure that question you never asked. Well, if Adam was as God was when he was sinless, how could sinless Adam fall to the temptations of Satan? He is so clever. Notice what the Bible says. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast in the garden. You know what he knew about you that you don't know about yourself? When your senses are overwhelmed, you lose control of your senses. And when you lose control of your senses, Satan takes control of your senses. This is why I teach in biblical boot camp. God must always be the governing source of your senses. God wants to govern your senses to keep you focused.
Yes.
Satan wants to control your senses to keep you out of the will of God. The whole essence, let me tell you something. Listen to this. Watch this. Sin. The reason why sin takes over, because your senses get overwhelmed. The reason why temptation is so effective is that your senses get overwhelmed. We're in the garden. Stick with me, okay? Satan, he began to talk to Eve, okay, about perverting the will of God. In essence, that's what the whole thing was. But he was subtle. He was crafty. God told them in the beginning, he said, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, except the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil. For in the day that you do eat of this tree, ye shall surely die. Good? So far, right? Y'all got that part. All right. Now, how is it that God gives them specific guidance instructions in their sinless state of mind that they still allow Satan and his suggestive influence to infiltrate their God nature? Because you do know that sinless, their nature was as God was. How did he get into that? Listen, listen, and listen, okay? When your senses get overwhelmed, you lose control. Huh? Now watch this. Here we go. You got to go with me on this teaching here. Satan, when he's trying to tempt Eve to get out of the will of God, here's what he does. He says, let me show you just how good this fruit would be for you. Here, smell it. Pleasing, huh? Touch it. Oh, you gotta taste this. Because in the day that you do, you'll be like the Most High. Did you not just hear me describe four of your senses just then? Sight, smell, touch, and taste. She's overwhelmed now. And guess what? Because she entertained the suggestive thoughts of Satan, she has now allowed him to infiltrate her God nature. Yes, yes. Now, it wasn't over because he infiltrated, because God says, resist the devil and he'll flee. Amen. The failure was the failure to resist. Y'all there? But look at it now. Her sight has been overwhelmed. Her sense of smell has been overwhelmed. Oh, it had to be a very nice texture or something to feel. And what's left? Now you begin to salivate. You all know about Pavlov's theory? You know, you begin to salivate now. Uh-oh. What's left? The final episode is to disobey God. Amen. Now, look. Completely tricked her out of her nature. You are already as God.
Amen.
How can you let me get into your thinking? First of all, it should have been shut down when he started talking about that tree. Hello? Now, he already told you this was going to happen. But this is what happens when Satan begins to suggest things to us, we get curious about it.
Yes.
So he says, all I got to do, number one, get you to listen to me.
Yes.
If you allow me to have a conversation with you, I'm going to work on your senses from that point on. Okay, let's bring it home. How many of y'all fell for people? And think about how you feel for them. I know y'all never thought about this, but how you did. Your senses took over. Your senses got overwhelmed, and you ended up where you didn't want to be.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. Let me tell you how it happened. Okay. Men, we allow our senses to be overtaken by women. Women allow their senses to be overtaken by men and do something that is not of godly concern. Okay? You get out of the will of it. Y'all thinking about it now, aren't you? You know? Wow, he looked good to me. God forbid, he smelled good to me. Oh, just to feel those broad shoulders. Look at your senses now. Your senses getting beat down now.
Amen.
The rest is up to sin at this point. Can y'all see that?
Amen.
This is why, Eve, y'all talking about what you're going to tell Eve when you get to heaven. Eve, just like you are now.
Amen.
Adam was just like you now. Let me show you how Adam lost it. Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. What happened to Adam? What he was connected to, got to see.
Yes.
Uh-huh, y'all with me?
Yes.
So, when she got to see, instead of him resisting, he gave in to what he was connected to.
Yes.
And once sin got into him, that started the whole mess right there. Because he still was, notice I'm using my words carefully, he was as God was. Now watch this. Let me go ahead and answer the question for you. How Adam, sinless Adam, was able to fall and Jesus didn't fall. Because the comparison happens in Luke 4. In Luke 4, 1 through 13, this is where Jesus gets tempted by Satan. Now, Jesus tells you exactly how to resist Satan in Luke 4 and 1. Because since Adam fouled it up so bad in Genesis, Jesus comes as the example. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the know-how. I am the show you the way guy. How to get it done? Since Adam screwed it up, Luke 4 and 1 tells you how you're supposed to do. All right? Stick with me. We're going to do some more teaching today. Now, in Genesis, Adam failed, the reason why he failed, is a simple answer to it. And the answer is, he was only in the image and the likeness of God. He was not God. You all Photoshop pictures? Y'all know how y'all Photoshop pictures make yourself look real good? My wife showed me that stuff now. You know, you can look on Facebook and ugly people turn pretty. But the only reason, but, check it out. The image that ends up still could only be produced out of the real thing. I don't care how it looks now. I don't care how you Photoshop it. You can't Photoshop my face and make it look like somebody else. You know, you probably, it'd be close to it or whatever, but you got to take my features and Photoshop them, you know, get the ugly off of it and try to make it look better, you know, to make it look, but that's still me. I was the original thing. So as an image and as in the likeness of a thing, it can be altered. But the reason why Jesus couldn't fall, because he was God,
yes,
and he couldn't deny himself.
Yes. Amen.
Adam could deny his existence, but God could not deny himself. How Adam fell, because he was only in the image and the likeness of God. It was the image and the likeness of God that gave him capacity. And capacity is free will.
Yes.
I give you the capacity to remain under the power and the authority of me, as long as you don't disobey me. Even to this day, as long as we don't disobey God, we are collectively under the power and the authority of God. We can operate under that power and authority. But the moment that we disobey God, the power and authority is lifted. Hence, you have the Spirit of God departing.
Amen.
Y'all okay? I told you you're going to learn something today. Now, it's a tough thing to come to Kingdom Faith thinking you're going to learn something. Listen to this. So, going back to this Adam piece now, because I know nobody ever asked a question. That should have been your first surprise that I asked the question. How is it that sinless Adam could fall and Jesus not fall? What was so, now, he's at his best posture right now. But you got to understand, God created man for worship. Without a free will, you all, you can't worship. I must choose to serve God, and that makes God happy because I choose to serve him. If I force you to serve God, then you become a slave against your will. This is what it says in the verse here. It talks about, he knows that the children of Israel were oppressed. They were forced to do something against their will. Now, he's telling them, I'm coming to free you. I am that I am, the sovereign God who needs no one else to be God. I'm coming to rescue you. Hello? Listen, y'all. Hold on. If God is in everything, don't you think he can control everything?
Yes.
There is nothing that lives that God is not in. When it's time to shut Satan down, don't you know he can shut him down? Why do you think the bomber continued to bomb, that dude with the pipe bomb? Why do you think he continued? God says enough is enough. Now, don't get it twisted. He didn't allow it, but evil did it. Okay, it's time for you to get caught now. I'm still God. I can shut you down. But I'm hoping that you, me, everyone else, understand that we're raising little bombers in our house. When we don't pay attention to little bombers, when we don't raise them in the nurture and the admonition of God, we're just going to repeat this cycle. See, that's a warning in case y'all didn't know. How did he become that? Because I know as a kid, making a bomb in the house, man, please, you almost don't want to strike a match in my house. Okay? So, the fear of God was there. All that stuff, that craziness, locking your room door, this is your room. Oh, no. You want your own room, you buy your own room. That's how you got one. Nothing was, but now we got all of this, you know, kinder, more gentler parents. You're parents, okay? You have to raise your child. Just like Jesus, just like God. As long as we obey God, we have access to everything God has. But when you disobey God, restrictions come upon you. Hello? Oh, it's good. It's getting better. Now, watch this, you all. Do you not recognize that in the beginning, God says, when I created man, I give him all the provisions that he needs so he does not have to work.
Amen.
He's free to serve me all the time. Do y'all know that? You do recognize that sin is the reason why you work now? For your provisions? All of your provisions were given so that you wouldn't have an excuse. What is the biggest excuse why people don't come to church now? What is the biggest excuse why people, oh, Rosa, the light bulb went off. They got to work. Ain't that something? But that's not even the problem, okay? You got to work. Let me tell you something that gets bigger now, see? in God, I would have selected the right job that would have given me the freedom to worship God. Because of poor stewardship is why you work now. You aren't a good steward over your finances. You're not a good steward over your resources. And you surely didn't allow God to pick the job for you. Okay. Well, I had to get a job. You're right. You had to get a job without God. Because now, if you want the high-paying job, guess what you got to do? You got to go get an education to get that job. You got to stay the course to get that kind of money. So you can't blame it on, because I work at McDonald's. Whose fault is that? Every one of us get the same 24 hours in every day. So the person that's making the kind of money that you're making, why they're making it, you're not. There was a degree of discipline that you don't have. So this ain't the church for your excuses, all right? And you aren't dead, you're still living, so you still can pull it off. You're not stuck in anything. God is the giver of life. Y'all, you want to quote scriptures to me, you say he promised you long life, so put some of that long life to work if you're not where you want to be. Now, if you're where you want to be, life is okay for you. I'm not talking to you. But those of you who are making excuses, because see, let me tell you something. You can't tell me if God is orchestrating your job finding, he's going to lead you to a job that will allow you the freedom to worship. He knows you got to work. But he's going to allow you the freedom. And it's not, it's not over with. You can still have that. You know, because I was talking to my wife on the way in here. There are certain religions, you know, I think the Muslim type religion or whatever, and when they want to pray during the day on the job, you can't stop them from praying. Y'all do know that, right? Because that's violating their religion. So if they want to lay out their cloth and do whatever they got to do, the job, by law, has to allow them to do it. So why can't that same law allow you to attend services? Hello? Why do you have to work on every time? I don't care what day in this ministry that I put a service together, a consistent schedule. Y'all know the schedule been the same ever since y'all been in this church, okay? So maybe Tuesday night ain't the night we can do it. Is there another night we can do this so I can be in Bible study? Oh, I have to work. God forbid, I put something on Thursday night. You got to work on Thursday. Now, how convenient am I to your schedule? We do it once a year, and now all of a sudden you work Thursday night now. You know, you got to work, you work. But here's what I'm telling you. The reason why you work is the same reason you're making the excuses, because of sin. Now, Pastor, how can you say that? I just told you. Ask God for the job that you can need. Ask God to give you the job that will allow you the freedom to serve. Did y'all even put that? I just need a good job. I need the money. And we chase the money. That's fine. I understand you need finance. But did you ask? There are good jobs out there, you all, that pays that kind of money, that gives you the freedom to worship. Did you ask God about the job? Same job that you do. There are employers that will allow you the freedom to serve your God. Hello? I know it's tight up in here today, but it's all right. It's going to get tight. Trust me. Now listen to this, you all. We're talking about the sovereign God. God is in everything that you do. He's a part of everything. Without God, there is nothing that can be done that is done. Is that okay? All right. Now, so here's what I need you to do. Put my thing on never, because it's moving for me. I got to put it on never. But listen, when we call ourselves, understanding this God that we serve, I want to go back to something right quick here, because I think it's really important that you get it. If God is not in everything that you do, then what you do is subject to faith. You do understand that, right? But God wants you to have great things. Just include me in. Let me show you the greatest lesson, you all. The greatest lesson in understanding how to pull it off is tithing. Do you not know that? Forget about the money aspect, right, about giving your money. Tithing is about stewardship. That's the greatest lesson in the Bible about stewardship. If you can do whatever you do, give God his 10%, or give 10%, then the rest of your life, because if I'm listening, everything about God starts at the top, okay? It starts at the top and works its way down. If you tithe, I'm going to tell you how to handle your 90%. I'm going to teach you how to steward over your 90% to such a degree it exceeds anything you could have ever done with your 100%. I will just happen to have you show up at the right places where you can get this stuff for half price that you was going to pay full price for. That is stewardship. That comes from listening to the inspirations of God, you all. Is that okay? Oh, come on, y'all. Y'all gotta do better than that. Listen. The spirit of a thing governs and controls everything about the thing. Okay? You do understand? The spirit of anything governs and controls the outcome of that thing. The spirit of a human being governs and controls whatever the outcome that you see, the animation that you get to witness. Okay? In animals, the spirit of an animal, it governs and controls the outcome that you see. The spirit in a plant say what you want to, and you can say anything you want. Talk to your plants and watch what happens to them. For those of you with the brown thumb, talk to your plant and watch what happens. There's a reciprocal response that happens when you start talking to plants. The spirit, the connection is made. Y'all think that's some great epiphany? I'm telling you, this is how God put it together. Okay? So, as simple as that was, you never thought about including God in how that comes to be. Why do people who talk to their plant have beautiful plants? Come on, y'all. This is just simple stuff, but you don't think about it. So the enemy counts on you not studying the word of God. Oh, that's big right there in and of itself. The reason why you have to study is so that God can reinforce himself in you. You study truth so you can become what God has for you to be. And in studying truth, you meet the approval of God. Because if I only study truth, then I'm only going to animate truth. And the reason why that studying to God is study to show yourself approved, he says, I need you to study, to constantly regurgitate this in your mind, whatever you want to call it, until you get it, until it becomes you. Because once it becomes you, you begin to animate it. Now, here we go. That which is seen now is temporal. That which they don't know, I have the Spirit of God in me all the time. So all you're going to see is me animate God. It's not a flip-flop for me. Is not seen is eternal. When the Bible talks about it being eternal, that's what determines your destination. Will it be in heaven or will it be in hell? So you can sit in front and pretend all day, all you want. This is why you have, check it out. This is why you have scriptures like this. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. According to your faith, according to what you consistently hear, let it be unto you. If you're hearing the voice of God, then God type results is what you're going to get. Is this like way over your head? Please tell me it ain't. Please tell me we got this. Listen, here it is. Perhaps the most toxic part about sin, you all, is the ability to choose. You get to choose between evil and good. That is the most toxic part about it. You get to reason now whether I want to do good or whether I want to do evil. Sin has got so many values to it, negative values to it, that if you don't study the word of God, you will constantly be defeated. I don't care how wise you pretend to be, and you will only understand this if you form a relationship with God. Without a relationship, I'm speaking Chinese to you right now. And I know, you just sitting here bobbing your head, but if you don't have a relationship with God, this is, and all you got to do is decide that you want to have a relationship with God, and this begins to make sense to you. So don't fight, I told you all before, don't fight with people who don't understand your God. The only reason they don't understand your God or even begin to grow in the things of your God is because they don't have a relationship with him. Understanding God, you all, carte blanche is about relationship. You understand, look, you get more out of God than you put into God, okay? Sometimes we say you get into it, what you put out, you get out of what you put into it. No. Put something into God. It's 30, 60, and 100-fold return. Hello? You don't just get a one-for-one. Nothing you do in God will give you a one-for-one return. Nothing. Everything you put into God, it will be eclipsed by your little bitty effort. Amen. And how is it that, I bet if your money changed like that, you'd be on top of that, wouldn't you? Okay. Let me find a bank to get, see everybody, yes sir, my money boy, see? Can y'all put God ahead of your money? And your money probably will move a lot faster or be more effective to you. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm just throwing that out there. Y'all all right so far?
Amen.
Listen, man has always had the free will. You asked the question the other night, but man has always had the free will to choose. Let this mind be in you. You're going to learn something this week in Biblical Boot Camp. The mind is the chooser of thought patterns. You'll either choose to think like God or you'll choose to think like Satan. And within the mind, you have an element. The major element of the mind is free will. It allows you the opportunity to choose. Now, when you choose, your source of influence become the eternal you. Hello? Because that's what you listen to. So that's what you operate in. So if God is your source of influence, then the eternal you and the internal you collectively come together to form a God-type person. Hello? Watch this, you all. Prior to sin, Adam was a God being. After sin, he became a human, fallible being. Prior to sin entering his thinking, worship God in spirit, in your thinking, and in truth, your behavior, your animation, consistent. Worship God in spirit, in your thinking, and in truth, how you carry yourself. Your truth is who you are for real. You can pretend, but it's about being consistent, okay? When sinless Adam gave way to sin, you all, he no longer was a God being. That's what gave him the power and authority to call him sinless. He was a God being at that time. When sin entered his thinking, reasoning between good and evil became a part of his thinking. It is at that point he became a human, fallible being. And at that moment, listen very carefully, the Spirit of God departed him. How else could he get out of the will of God? Spirit of God was still in him. That's not hard to even reason. Now, that doesn't mean he dies and go to hell, but now you got to work for it from this point on, okay? This is why I teach you about the anointing. The anointing postures you for God's use. We learned it last week in Biblical Boot Camp. The Spirit of God comes upon you for the assignments and the tasks that you're going to do, because if God is going to get the glory out of you, what you do, you're going to have to complete your task. So the Spirit of God comes upon you, anoints you for completion. Other than completion, you'll be distracted. And listen. Your senses become overwhelmed. I feel real, real sleepy now. So I'm going to study the Bible after I wake up. When I wake up, I feel real, real hungry. So I got to go eat. And I eat now, I'm behind time. I study when I get home. Whole lot of things getting in the way of what you said you were going to do. And all of these things are senses driven. Y'all good? So when we talk about this sovereign God that we serve and how he operates in us, you all, you got to understand, God is in everything that we do. Listen to this. I know y'all know scriptures pretty good. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Where is the secret place of the Most High? Don't burn yourself out. There it is. It's in his thinking. If any man be in Christ, if any man be inspired by Christ, if any man be inspired by God, he is in spirit. And to be in spirit means you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. It takes all of that, okay? And it's not that difficult. If I be in Christ, I'm inspired by Christ. How else can I be in him if I'm not inspired by him? And when I'm inspired by him, I am walking in the spirit. Therefore, I will never fulfill the lust of the flesh as long as I am inspired by God. Because you know what it is? This is so good. Please, 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 please. You ever seen that commercial on TV? Wow. That little egg frying in the pan? And it says, this is your brain on drugs? Your flesh. Oh, goodness, this is good. Your flesh, you all, is your senses on evil. Your spirit is your senses on God. Hello? Ain't that good? Your senses on evil, your senses on evil, that's your flesh. Your senses on God being governed by God is your spirit. Because if God is governing my spirit, he keeps it in control. Because I'm yielded to the voice. I'm walking by faith. I hear the voice. So God says, look, don't go that route. Don't touch that forbidden fruit. Because let me tell you what the forbidden fruit was so you all get this teaching well. The forbidden fruit, you all, was a senses magnet. It was a senses magnet. All of Eve's senses was drawn to that forbidden fruit. But what would allow her to resist that was the keeper on the inside of her. This is why you have the keeper on the inside of you to help you govern your senses. Y'all okay with that? Oh, please give some credence to your senses, okay? Because it's very important. I know you got it deep, because I tell you in my teachings, when I teach you, your soul is where your senses operate, your emotions, your emotions, senses driven. Your will, senses driven. Your intellect, senses driven. Hello? Everything about your soul is governed by your senses. Hello? If learning makes you feel good, you continue to learn. So your intellect grows. It's not hard. I know. You haven't heard it this way, but I'm telling you this is true. Because I think everybody can relate to it. If my senses are overwhelmed, I no longer have control over my senses. What keeps my senses from being overwhelmed is the God in me, the keeper in me, the Holy Ghost in me. He tells me when to back down, what to back away from. Don't go into this place. Get away from that. I don't ask. See, this is good. This is why Jesus was so effective, you all. He never questioned the inspiration of his Father. If he was inspired by God, it was so for him. There was nothing to reason. He never considered the idea of the inspiration of God not working. He never once considered his Father's inspiration not working. You and me, to this day, we sit here and sometimes, most of the time, we consider whether the inspiration of God will work. Get out. Don't put that false humility on, because let me tell you what. Every time you disobey God was a time you doubted his inspiration. See, I'm just going to cut to the chase, okay? Every time we disobey God was a time that we doubted his inspiration. Why else would we disobey? No wiggle room today. We're teaching for effect. Is this good?
Amen.
We're talking about this sovereign God, the God of everything. The sovereign God that we're talking about, he possesses attributes, if you will. There's a nature behind it. And in that nature, you have the omniscience of God, the all-knowingness of God, the omnipotence of God, the all-power of God, the omnipresence of God everywhere, time, space, matter, all at the same time. You understand that? Everywhere, all the time, at the same time, in everything that is. This is the omnipresence of God that you serve. You get that? So when you talk about this sovereign God, it means that he's God all by himself. There's a formula that you all remember me teaching in here. God minus you, he's still God. You minus God, you're nothing. Hello?
Amen.
And that is the real. Because if God take his spirit from you, you literally are nothing.
Amen.
You are powerless to life. You are powerless to thought and the influence. This is why. Whenever the enemy comes upon you, the Bible says this. Apply some resistance. Resist. You know how you guys get a jump on resistance? Spiritual exercises for the mind. Praying, studying, fasting, meditation. That is how you build up your spiritual muscle. So when the enemy tries to accost you or overwhelm you, you got this thing. This is how Jesus did it in Luke 4:1-13. 4:1-13. Every time Satan says something to him, he says it is written. He resisted. And the enemy had to flee. Unlike Adam, Adam didn't resist. He gave place to him. Do you know that what happened to Eve, you all, this is good. Eve allowed the enemy to test drive her senses. You know that song you say? If you let him ride, he'll want to drive. Don't let him ride. Y'all remember that song? I know your old people remember that song. Don't let the devil ride. She let him ride. He began to ride her senses. And he rode her literally into crazy. She became totally about chaos and spiritual destruction when he let him take over, because he made it sound better than what it was supposed to sound like. Because anytime Satan can make disobeying God sound good to you, guess what? Your senses have now been overwhelmed. If Satan can make something that you know you shouldn't be doing sound better than what God has told you not to do, your senses have been overwhelmed. Don't feel bad, because all of us have been victim to that. And some of us are still victim to that. I'm trying to teach you how to overcome it. If you, Jesus, never considered disobeying his Father. There's the difference now. Adam, maybe killed him. Because he says, in the day that you disobey me, you shall surely die. You want to live? Obey God. If you don't, disobey and die. See how easy that is? And dying is to be spiritually separated prior to physical death, okay? Y'all okay? Hey, that wasn't too much, was it? But I want you to understand who you serve, okay? God is in everything that lives. Everything that exists, God is a part of it. And if he's not a part of it, you all, you shouldn't be a part of it either. How about that? Mm-hmm. I I like this stuff. Boy, this is some good stuff here. Listen. I told you about that part already. Oh, here we go. You have to see walking in the spirit more than a cliche. Okay? Because, you know, we say, we've taken many of the scriptures, especially the short ones, we've turned them into cliches, but they are yet God's truth. When he says, walk in the spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh, don't turn that into a cliche. Please let it remain true in you. How do I walk in the spirit? I'm always connected to God. I'm always studying more and more about God. I'm always learning more and more about God. You, leader, how can you lead if you don't learn? You think that you have enough wisdom now to lead the people of God? You do know that evil is reinventing itself every day. So in order for you to stay ahead of evil, you're going to have to stay connected to God. Y'all realize that? See, the way my mother and father handled it, evil's a little bit more advanced than that now, okay? Now, not that God has changed, but the evil has changed, okay? So we're going to have to use some different methods and techniques to do that, all right? You know that? It's kind of funny to me. I told y'all I'm new to Facebook, right? So I ain't that good at it yet. But see, if you check my page, I pray you go to my page. Because Mr. JC, my friend, okay? Mr. JC, you like some of that inspiration, because see, he gives me thumbs up, see? I know people look at my page, so you gotta work. You can look at my page 2 o'clock in the morning. I ain't gonna be on it, but you can look and see what I left on there. Because my point is this, you all, I'm the same person all the time. And me and my wife talk about this. People tell me, oh, they looking at my page. I don't want them looking at my page. Christians should never have to say that about their Facebook page, okay? I'm trying to get into your little social media group, and I ain't been there. So I'm trying to work with y'all, man. Quit talking about y'all on Facebook, okay? But now, my thing is, though, you're no less Christian on a Facebook page. I see I stepped out there. Now I'm out there. I don't want people looking at my page. Christian, why? What you got on your page? If you got something on your page that God can't see, probably ought not be on your page. What you think? Now, see, people looking at my page. I just told you about the Photoshop, okay? Huh? Ugly people turn pretty? And then you go to look at them like, where's this person I was looking for? That ain't you. Oh, yeah, that's me, you know, it was a different light. A whole lot of light different, okay? It wasn't even on when you took this picture, yeah. All right? But this is kind of stuff, bring me back. Okay, but I'm telling you, the God, the sovereign God that you serve, you are, you got to know how to operate. Seriously. Because I'm ineffective. Listen, do you think that this teaching would not be interesting to somebody if you were able to do it? Now, you're going to get your notes in a little while, and you can study it, and you can do this. But people need to know that. Man, you know, well, because we kind of mess it up. We say, because I think I caught myself. I had checked myself. I think I always say he was as God in my teaching, because if I ever say Adam was God, you know, because I know I've taught it this way, that the first man, Adam, was God's intent. I'm sure I said that. You know, sinless. I think I said that. I'll have to go back. But I'm going to fix it if I said it other than this. Adam was never as God, sinless, he was as God, okay? I'm putting emphasis on that. So I'm going to go back and check some teaching. I can't undo the teaching, but from this day forward, I don't think I said it that way, because in my mind, I can't even, it's kind of awkward for me to say that Adam was God. But we have to understand, he was as God. And as God, sinless, he was God in the fourth person, the human being. That's who he was, okay? Now, in sin, he was no longer that person. But Jesus, as the second man, Adam, at no time was he not God. Can you imagine denying yourself, walking around saying that you're not J.C. Woodard? That'd be pretty strange, wouldn't it? Now, everybody in town knows you may go change your name, but the spirit is still that individual. Well, this is why Jesus couldn't fall, you know, because he was the rule maker. You do know that Jesus was God in a flesh suit?
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
Y'all do know that, right?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You sitting here trying to convince me to deny me. That's how stupid Satan was in Luke 4:1. And he kept saying, notice what he said. He said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. He never said, you don't tempt my father. You know, he says, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Everything. I'm talking to you. You still talking to me, oh ignorant one? You don't know you're talking to me. You're trying to convince me to go against me. Okay, I guess you're tired now. And the Bible says he departed for a season, meaning he's coming back. He's going to try something else. But the objective is to resist it. In weightlifting, in resist, you get stronger. The more resistance you use, the more strength you get. Spiritually, the more you resist the temptations to do evil, the stronger you get to walk away from it when it shows up. You now understand something probably you didn't understand before. Don't allow your senses to become overwhelmed. You know? A lady taught me this a long time ago. She told about us men. Okay? She said, the ignorant thing about you men is y'all don't know how to take a snapshot and keep it moving. We get caught. We're going to follow you through store. Oh, boy. We following her like a robot programmed to stupid. Okay? Whereas a woman, she takes a snapshot. And she remembers what she needs to remember about it. If it's something she wants to pursue, she knows how to do it. Not us. No, sir. We got to tell everybody in the store we pursuing it. We got to tell everybody in this. And now, unless you real, real ignorant, you ain't going to give us the time of day. Because, see, we too stupid. And that's a dumb man. What y'all think?
Amen.
Okay. I'm sorry for going out there where we live at, okay? In the world we live in. The point, you all, you cannot allow your senses to be overwhelmed. Because as soon as your senses are overwhelmed, sin is inevitable. You understand that? The sovereign God that you serve is the God of everything. Without God, you all, there was no creation. There was no form. Everything was yet void. Until God incorporated himself in a thing was when void went away. When God incorporated himself into this world was when creation came into being. Prior to God, putting himself, now God has always been. Please understand that. But prior to himself putting himself into creation was without form and it was void. Is that good?
Amen.
Here we go, y'all, and I'm going to wrap this up. My wife's smart lady, you know, she's smarter than me. All right? So I just come in here pretend I'm smart. She's smarter than me. And this is the thing that I want y'all to remember. She said this, and she saw it somewhere, but I thought it'd be great for teaching, okay? Even sugar looks like salt. Maybe that's why the Bible says, oh, taste and see the Lord that he's good. It can look like a whole lot of stuff. But until you get some of this in you, you have no idea what it's about. Amen?
Amen.
All right, y'all. Hey, thank y'all for listening to us today.
Awesome.
We're going to invite you all out to Kingdom of Faith World Outreach Ministry. Our address is 108 Top Hat Street. We hope you heard something today that blessed you. Hey, we want you to come out. We're recruiting choir members, we want everything. Whatever you do, whatever your gift, if you can't sing, if you can blend, whatever you do, we want you here. 108 Top Hat Street, Fayetteville, North Carolina. Our service times are at 9 o'clock. We start our worship service. And on Tuesday night, our Bible study begins at 7 o'clock. I'm punctual. My Bible studies, they start from 7 and they end punctually at 8:30. So please come out and join us. On Thursday nights, we have Biblical Boot Camp, a newcomer's teaching. And it starts from 7 to 8:30 as well. We welcome you. We're excited that you joined us on this broadcast today. And continue to tune in. And we hope one day we'll see your face in the place. God bless you.